Hi, we're at Logan, Ohio for the first annual dual sport trail ride promoted by the Hocking Valley Motorcycle Club. At sign-in, all riders' bikes have to pass a sound test to assure that all of them are quiet. Factory reps are on hand at all the Dual Sport Series events. Mark Hyde of Suzuki tells what dual sport riding is all about.
Basically, that's what dual sporting is all about. You know, I started out riding, my dad and he had some friends, and they had sons about my age, and we used to go trail riding every weekend. And, you know, we had a ton of fun, and basically that's what the dual sport thing has gotten us back to. You know, it's a way to get out on the weekend on totally street legal motorcycles, and they're nice and quiet, which helps our sport more than anything, mm-hmm. I think. And, you know, now with the land usage, the way it's been, it's taken away some of our trails. So this way we can go ride a section of trail, jump on the highway, ride to another section of trail, or, you know, like down here at Hocking Valley, there's some nice little towns around the area. We can start here, ride someplace, have lunch, you know, and ride back into the trails and just, like I said, have a fun weekend.
Phil Lindemann is also on hand from Honda.
We have three of the trucks, like you can see behind us here, and located throughout the country. So we've been trying to go to each of the national series, and we've just been trying to support it. We have product now with street legal dirt bikes that it's kind of a new and up and coming sport. We keep seeing more and more riders each year attend the dual sport rides, and we're just real enthused. We have a lot of good responsible people that show up here with quiet bikes. They're street legal, and it seems like everybody's just having a good time.
Very involved in the support of dual sports. Sales-wise, it's been real good for us. You know, if we don't sell motorcycles, we're not in business. But it kind of goes beyond that because, you know, as a motorcycle company, we're enthusiasts, and we really enjoy the sport. And what we try to do is make sure everybody has a fun weekend. You know, if a guy comes a long way to ride one of these events and has a problem, hopefully we can fix that problem, and, you know, he'll get on his way, he'll get his weekend of riding in, and he'll enjoy himself, and that way, you know, he tells his buddies about it, and maybe he can bring some of his buddies back. Because we see a lot of the dual sport people are people that used to ride, and they kind of get out of it because they didn't want to go racing every weekend. They've got a wife and kids and a house and things like that. And this way, it gets them back involved in the sport again.
Mm-hmm. Before each day's ride, there's always a riders' meeting.
First of all, on behalf of the Hocking Valley Motorcycle Club, Logan, Ohio, we want to welcome all of you. We've dialed in two nice days of weather, so you shouldn't have any problem with that. The overall terrain will be good. You'll have some alternatives for those of you who want to test your skills. You can do that.
On behalf of American Suzuki, I'd like to thank everybody for showing up today. The club worked real hard this weekend, so you know, you'll have a really good ride. They got this nice weather for you. And I just want to say I'll be out and about. If anybody needs anything, hopefully I've got it in the truck and we can get you running so you can enjoy the weekend. And then Phil Lindemann and myself, tonight, starting about 5:30, 6 o'clock, we're going to have a little bike prep and rider seminar back here at the finish. Our two trucks will be parked side by side, and we'll have a tent set up and everything. And maybe we'll show you how to change it. Phil says he'll show you how to change a tire in 5 minutes or less. And I want to be around and see that. So, like I said, we just want to get you going here, and thanks for coming, and hopefully you have fun out there today.
And here we are in the first wood section. Today's the last day of turkey hunting season, so trail sections could not be entered until noon. So, the ride started with about 50 miles of beautiful country back roads. Thank you. are at the end of the first wood section. This is the first split in the trail. Those who take the road have an easy ride. The rest enter the first A section. This is also a good place to take a break.
Over 50, it's as good as sex.
Well, I'll tell you what.
I know what you're talking
about. From here on, it's practically all trail.
Good.
To the lunch stop.
Let me get my bike out.
So the cat the gas stuff said
that
one turkey hunter came by and touched me.
Yeah. People get interested in trail riding. Well, let's ask Mark Hyde.
Well, basically, my sister and I, we wanted to get, you know, some friends of ours had mini bikes, and we thought that was a lot of fun, so we saved our money and bought ourselves a bike.
Okay, and you got into racing, and were pretty successful at it, weren't you?
Yeah, my racing career has been very successful. You know, for me, you know, basically, we started out play riding, and then, you know, one thing led to another, and we heard about racing, and,
That's okay.
Yeah. We heard about racing, and we went and tried some, then tried some more, and one thing led to another, and then I ended up getting a factory ride from all my local success, and went on to some national championships.
And you rode enduros or hair scrambles?
I rode both. I had most of my success in hair scrambles, though.
Mm-hmm. Now we are in the A section. As you can see, the hills are steeper and the trails are narrower. Getting a little bit of traffic bunched up. Here's one of the ladies that was on the ride. She's a little bit of a newcomer, but she's trying the A section. Bob Aldred on a 1969 Greaves.
My knee a little.
Bob's a regular rider at most of these dual sport rides. Father and daughter team.
You okay?
Okay, hang on, ladies.
You all right now? Did you get mud on the seat, Jesse?
Boy, they threw all that. Something so simple.
Thank you. You can see these are public trails, part of the Wayne Trail System. And because of that, they have two-way traffic.
Easiest thing in the world to ride. They can't do it. Even though the weather's dry this weekend, there's always mud somewhere. It seems like some of these places never dry up.
guys and get to ride two motorcycles. This is a bit.
Here we are at the lunch stop at the firehouse in Carbon Hill. Here, riders get a full sit-down meal each day. And now we're back out on the trail. Right after lunch, there's a big, long hill. Here comes one of our favorite female riders, Pat Shepard. Followed right along by her daughter. Pat tells us how she got started with trail riding.
Well, our predicament was that her dad and my boyfriend were riders of the enduro stage. So they would come home from the enduro races or rides and complain or either marvel at the tricks that they had pulled when they were out there in the woods. And we thought, this is unfair that the female does not get involved with this. So then Paul took it upon himself to get Jennifer a bike and myself, and we started with the trail riding. And the dual sport riding is the best thing that's happened to the female rider or the person who basically has always had the helmet at home. Now we can get involved. It's a lot of fun. Trail riding is a lot of fun, but it requires practice and plenty of skill, too. So let's pick up a few tips from Mark Hyde.
Hi, I'm Mark Hyde of American Suzuki. I'd like to welcome you to this segment of our dual sport riding tips. What we're going to cover here is braking on downhills. What you want to do is apply your brakes before you make any turns, so that way your front wheel is going straight and you get the most effective braking power. Also, your front wheel does about 70% of your stopping, but it's very critical to have good feel with the front brake and not to lock it. Whenever you're like rolling over an obstacle like a log or preparing for a corner, you need to let off on the front brake, complete your maneuver, and then get back on the brakes. You want to make sure you're in a standing position with your weight slightly back and dragging both brakes. Make your maneuver and then back on the brakes or back on the gas. So we are at a more brisk pace, always looking where we're going and completing our maneuvers. Okay, and now on our next attempt to cross an obstacle, we're going to attempt some mud holes. Usually there's two ways to cross mud holes. You can either go the slow, safe way, or the fast, could be dangerous, but sometimes you make it way. The big thing you have to take into consideration is your own riding ability and the chances you want to take. Again, as we talked with downhills, vision is a key factor. If you stay looking up the trail, you can see the obstacle ahead of you and have more time to prepare for it. I'll demonstrate both ways and you have to make the decision what way will work best for you. We'll start with the quick, safe way. As you can see, I've come up on a mud hole, and by looking ahead, I can see there's a nice alternate way around it, so I'll be able to zip around nice and quick and safe. And almost stuck. Here we come. We see an obstacle we want to avoid. Just look around, look up, see a nice, easy line around. Hope you enjoyed your riding tips from Suzuki's Dual Sport Club today. Hope to see you on the trail.
Here comes Pat Shepard again. This time, though, it doesn't look like she's got quite enough momentum to get over those big rocks. Here's Pat's daughter, Jennifer. Looks like she motors right on through.
How we doing?
Thank you. right way?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
After a day on the trail, there's nothing like a relaxing evening around it. Well, it looks like Mark Hyde got suckered into demonstrating how to change a tire.
Okay, on changing tire here, this is the one that everybody has big problems with it, but there's no reason for it. The key to getting a fast tire change is to getting your steps down, doing it the same way every time. Another big help is tire irons. This is basically all I use. They've got a spoon on one end, and at the other end, I put a groove in. That's very important for when you're putting it back on, and it makes it really reduces your chance to pinch a tire. And basically what you want to do, you always want to start at the valve core, taking it off, and then when you're putting it back on, you want to finish at the valve core. And what I do, I've already taken the tire off the bike, I've let the air out, and I've loosened my rim lock. And I also too, with running one rim lock, I always run it next to the valve stem, makes tire changing much easier. Basically, first thing you need to do is take and break the bead down. You can either do this by stomping on it or riding on it for 5 miles while it's flat. Or get Jake here. And it works a lot better in riding gear too. Okay, another thing is you always want to change it with the sprocket down. Again, I use the hook ends of the tire irons to take it off. And the key to getting a tire on and off is you want to get this side drop down into the center drop. So by doing that, you don't really stretch the tire. You get this side in the center drop, and then this side comes off. And then, like I said, and you want to start by and put both your tire irons in with, and you start with little bites. And then as the closer you get to the end, the bigger the bites you can take.
How far down do you put the grooves on the other end?
About a quarter inch in is all they are. And then two, let me pull this off of here and I'll show you what I'm talking about. Sorry about that, buddy. See, now Vic Ely did that one time at 6 days in Italy, and they're still a little Italian with severe brain damage. No, I'm not talking about Vic. Obviously, this crowd knows Vic better than I thought. Okay. Well, you know, I want you guys to see it. Yeah, got all weekend. Now the thing too is duct tape, I always go like two wraps around on the center. That way you eliminate that rubber rim strap that always gives you problems and things like that. And then another key is what I do when my bikes are new. I take the stock tubes out and I replace them with Metzler heavy duty tubes. This does two things. It gives you a nice spare tube to carry with you on a dual sport ride.
It gets permission out of it, too.
No, and the Metzler heavy duty tube really reduces your chance for a flat. I mean, it's like twice the thickness of a standard tube. Makes a huge difference in your chances of getting a flat tire. And also, too, on the new tire, what I do is I put baby powder on the inside to reduce chafing, and then on the bead, I put a little bit of Armor All on the bead, so it goes on like that. Now, some tires you have to be careful with; they're directional, and so you want to make sure you get them on whichever way you want. And then when you're putting it on, let's see, you want to again make sure your sprocket side is down. So again, get that side in, and by putting the rim lock next to the valve core. Can kind of just feed them both in there together at the same time. And the first bead, put it on the tire. Now this is where the grooves that we talked about come into play. Again, I've got the grooves on the backside, and then when you have a hook, you want to make sure you put the groove here and the same size hook, because when you're working the tire iron, you have them over the other way. This digs into your hand, it's just a comfort reason. But again, like I said, you always want to start and finish at the valve core. So my valve core is up here in my rim lock, and I'll start on this side here. And what you do is I push the tire iron in and pull it back, and then that groove catches. And then the biggest thing where people pinch a tire is they'll come in like this, and they'll get here, and see, I push on with my knees, they'll take the tire iron and go, whoah. And then if the tube's in there, you catch it and you get two little snake bite looking marks. Common problem with tube pinches. But like I said, the big thing is you don't want to really go past 90 degrees here when you're putting your tube on.
Well, it's Sunday morning and we're back out on the trail.
Thank you. How's the ride going so far?
It's going great.
It's fun.
Yep.
Another one of our female riders, Debbie Kauffman from Louisville, Kentucky. Debbie tells us how she got started.
I've been involved in riding, motorcycle riding, since about 1980. I did street riding first, and then in about 1984 I started doing a little bit of dirt riding. Started out on an XR100 and have graduated to a 200 Kawasaki today. But okay. Enjoy the trail riding very much and have participated in some hair scrambles and some motocross races here lately, so it just gets better and better for me. Okay. It's a lot of fun. Turkey season may be over for the hunters, but there are still some turkeys in the woods. Casual trail riders often don't silence their bikes or wear adequate protective gear. Now here's a great combination. A bandana instead of a helmet on a three-wheeler. Here's a baseball cap worn backwards, which is not a very good substitute for a helmet. And a short-sleeved t-shirt instead of a riding jersey. Here come Pat and Jennifer again, and they just didn't take the easy way every time either.
On this course today, for instance, we had some A sections and some sections that everybody rode. How did you guys handle those?
Anybody? Piece of cake.
Okay. did you take the A sections?
Yeah, took all of them. In fact, we took a section of the alternate trail that we didn't know wasn't supposed to be taken today. So.
Did all three of you ride together?
Basically, we were spaced.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So. The thing of it is, with this type of riding now, we're being able to challenge it just like the guys. Now, we'll never race, but at least we can get out there and challenge the terrain like we've seen them do. Mm-hmm. And it's good. It's a good feeling.
Yep.
Hyde said that he'd get out and ride if he had time, and here he is.
Hey, how you guys doing?
The Hocking Valley Dual Sport Ride is one event everyone is looking forward to for next year.